How do you do, fellow kids? Welcome to the show. We've got a great one for you today. Not only are we never not working, but we're talking starts of the week, and we're going through half of the matchups for week two. Important stuff. Make sure you like the video, subscribe, leave your comments. We read them, and enjoy the show.
The Fantasy Footballer Studio is brought to you by Samsung Galaxy. Visit Samsung.com to learn more. Welcome to the Fantasy Footballers Podcast with your hosts, Andy Holloway, Jason Moore, and Mike Wright.
Oh, welcome in.
It's football time.
Whoa!
I almost forgot because I was very busy thinking about the hats. There is a hat situation on this show today, on the program.
There's a hat solution on the show today, Mike. How bad is my hair right now? You have no idea.
Okay, so you've solved...
I've solved my baldness.
Baldness cured.
Check it out. Bald? Not bald. Bald?
You two are wearing a very similar shirt today after the matching withstanding victories.
We are.
You look great today, Mike.
You look fantastic, Thank Jason. You. We both got a blue hue going on, which is surprising because Jason is 98% of the time a black shirt fella.
That's right. But I went a little crazy today. I'm wearing pink and purple shorts.
And a backwards hat and
a little athletic shirt. Yeah.
Welcome, fellow young kids.
Is this the midlife crisis?
He said, welcome, fellow young kids.
Yeah. Did you pull up in a vet today?
Oh, yeah. Top down, little Miata.
It's a Firebird. Oh. Firebird. By the way, 101, podcasting 101 is you want to bring the audience into the show by describing things we see visually.
That's right.
Well, that's one of the big keys. I know, Brooks, you taught us that, right? That's the key?
Oh, definitely.
Brooks also wearing a blue shirt, it looks like.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Okay.
You look beautiful back there, Brooks.
You look so beautiful. No?
Can we start this again? Never not working. News and notes, fantasy forecasts. We'll get into the matchups for week two today. Starts of the week on the show. Jason, obviously, bringing his boom boom kicker sophistication to the podcast today. How does the backwards hat feel?
Oh, the backwards hat feels excellent. Feels like I've got a little bit more energy today. Feels like I'm ready to dunk on fools through this show. You know, I'm just ready to go.
Yeah, and you're wearing, I mean, it looks all right. Looks pretty good. I'm gonna go to the pretty good side.
That is the nicest thing you've ever said.
What's the snap situation? Do you wear the hat where you're kind of, your head size is really in between the two snaps and you have to choose loose or tight, or does it work out all right?
I don't think so. I think
you're exactly a three button.
A three button guy.
Will there be a mark afterwards, or are you good?
I don't know. We'll find out.
All right. Well, we're done with that. Twitter at the FF Ballers. If you want to follow the show, follow Snapback Jason at Jason FFL. You're not changing your handle to Snapback Jason.
No, it is at Snapback Jason now. I did change it.
Mike is at FF Hitman. I'm at Andy Holloway. And you can become a part of the community at jointhefoot.com. Get a bonus weekly show, get access to a ton of premium in season perks. And we're making a lot of improvements for the supporters of the show.
That's right.
Lots of tools, the snapshot tool, stream finder. You can use the start sit tool with up to four players. There's a bunch of benefits to supporting the podcast, and we appreciate all of the Foot Clan. It is Thursday, though, and we have yet another special segment.
Never not working. Presented by Head & Shoulders Scalp Shield Technology. Available at Walmart.
All right. We are always working around here. And,
that's right.
And what we wanted to dive into and really provide stats for the Foot Clan is to combat a narrative of garbage time. We love garbage time, right?
Oh, the garbage man can.
Well, I would say we brought it up not just to combat it.
We respect garbage time.
Well, we respect, I'm saying, but what is the answer? Like, is garbage time really that valuable? That type of a thing. It wasn't.
How much is to be found within thy garbage?
Yes. Right. Yes. A lot of times you look.
Is it delicious?
You look at a situation. You go, they're going to be down. They're going to be throwing the ball a lot. So is this good? And so we wanted to give some data because we've all witnessed it, right? Like late in games.
Yes.
They're
of course
passing more. It's prevent defense. Now they're being able to move the ball. You get the Zach Ertz touchdown at the end of the game.
Yeah.
After
the Blake
he's done
Bortles.
Nothing. And so we wanted to find out with data. Is it valuable to target garbage time? I'm going to go ahead and spoil the answer. It's no. No, don't chase garbage time. Here's the data. When a team, we're looking basically at the quarterback position because as the quarterback goes, most of the team follows. When a team's win probability goes under 20%, they throw 70% of their plays. You think that's awesome for the quarterback. It sounds great, but they don't actually get any more efficient per play, even though passing is far more efficient than running the ball. We looked at every quarterback over the last 5 years, and we set a line of 12 points for the final score and who lost the game.
Like, and that's a because we're trying to look at a blowout.
Right, where there's actual garbage time, multiple scores. Yeah. Only 27% of quarterbacks in those losses finished with 18 fantasy points, which is basically like one of those 12 quarterbacks you should be starting in your league. The other 75%, nearly 75%, they average 197 yards and a half a touchdown.
It's not great.
As a turd.
Yes.
I mean, you don't want to start fantasy turds. And you can look at the Jets last week, right? The Jets, they threw the ball 59 times because they were down for most of the second half, had that garbage time, and yet Joe Flacco finished as the quarterback 21, Corey Davis, the wide receiver 31, Elijah Moore, the wide receiver 52, Garrett Wilson, the wide receiver 53. Throwing the ball does not make – look, if you're a bad team and you're down by a lot, you're having a bad game, you're just trying to get rescued out of terribleness, and every now and then it can happen, but the vast majority of time it doesn't. Whereas in close losses – 57% of quarterbacks in one score losses finished with that 18 plus fantasy points. It's more than double the rate of the guys in blowout losses, and they average 257 passing yards and 1.5 passing touchdowns. So how is this applicable? What are the takeaways? One, Vegas totals matter. Look at the game lines. Look at what's going on and try to get assets in those close games, those games that could be back and forth and you're not sure who's going to win, because in those like 10-point spreads, 85% of the time the favorite team wins, and a lot of times it's going to be a blowout. Don't assume that garbage time will save you. Inefficient offenses stay inefficient. And for week two, this is great timing. There are five games this week that basically have a 10-point spread, 9.5 or 10.5 points. Houston, Denver, Seattle, San Francisco, Chicago, Green Bay, Tennessee, Buffalo, and Atlanta against the Rams. So according to this data, don't really target those teams that are going to be down big and hope for garbage time.
Is it possible that I can ask for some, maybe a never not working follow-up at some point on this study? Because I am curious how that data translates to the running back position in particular. I think of the Flacco situation. 11 targets for Breece Hall, 9 targets for Michael Carter, 20 to the running backs in garbage time. This data is based on will the quarterback perform for fantasy, right? Mm-hmm. So do you guys already have any information on the running back position?
I can say that the laboratory is already filled with many scientists who are, in fact, studying.
So we are looking at this.
Yes, we are looking at it. We are top men.
So even though we have some data, we're never not working.
Yeah, we're always working over here.
Okay, and that would be the scientist you employ.
Yes.
Got it.
Well, it's sciencey stuff. It's really, you see here all the numbers that Jason was talking about? This is nerd stuff.
I don't know, if you listen close, you can hear the beakers right now. They are boiling. Work is getting done.
Okay, that's good. A lot of chemicals involved in this data.
Yes.
Get up to 100% dandruff protection that is never not working with Head & Shoulders Scalp Shield technology, available at Walmart.com. Use it every time you shampoo to see the difference.
News and notes from around the league. Presented by USAA Insurance.
Keenan Allen officially out for Thursday Night Football with the hamstring injury.
Yeah.
There is a silver lining of sorts to this situation. If it was Sunday, maybe he tries to get back too fast.
Mm-hmm.
Now you have he'll be absent tonight, but you have a full 10 days. They were optimistic about MRI results. I think there's a really good chance Keenan Allen returns for week 3 against Jason on my team.
Yeah.
Which is why your eyes rolled and I knew it immediately.
Yeah, I just want him to get extra healthy.
There's a great chance he will be back. However, I do believe there's a quote coming out from Keenan Allen right now. He is still telling people to play him tonight.
Okay, Mike. A little bit of bitterness?
No, what?
From years gone by?
From
I would never.
Isn't that more on you?
It on me that the athlete told me to play him?
Are you playing J.K. Dobbins this week? Because he would tell you to play him.
Yeah, he would.
All right. Oh, goodness. And that's the second bit of news here. Didn't even know it. J.K. Dobbins returned to a full practice Wednesday. Still listed as questionable. I mean, they need it. It's amazing watching the Ravens for now a year and a game where they just need a real running back. Not Devontae Freeman. Not Latavius Murray, not Kenyon Drake,
not Mike Davis.
They need a real running back, and will they get one this week?
Yeah, I don't know if J.K. Dobbins plays this week or not. Obviously, him being a full participant in practice is leaning that direction. But for fantasy purposes, you cannot play him in his first game back under any circumstance. I would play just about any running back out there. Once he's active, he will be a keep close eyes on him, watch his involvement, and you could say, well, if he has a great game, just deal with it on the bench, but he's not going to have a great game in his first game back.
Can I put it to the test?
Sure.
Saw J.D. McKissic on some waiver wires. Would you play McKissic over Dobbins?
Yes.
All right. Test completed. You passed. DeAndre Swift did it.
Oh, yep. Got me good. No.
I heard Al giggle over there. He's so happy when he gets to throw the McKissic drop.
I'm just so disappointed in myself. I guess I'm too busy trying to provide like meaningful content to the listeners that I just don't even pay attention to.
You did walk right up to the piece of cheese under the box.
And
you were like, oh, a piece of cheese.
Snap.
That's fair. DeAndre Swift did not practice on Wednesday, ankle injury. The team signed Justin Jackson from the practice squad. So, Mike, speaking of players saying that they're fine, DeAndre Swift said he's, quote, not at all concerned. Yet the team added Justin Jackson from the practice squad.
Yeah, the addition of Jackson moving to the actual active roster, that's not fantastic for the outlook of DeAndre Swift. It was just Wednesday, so at least you have multiple days of practice reports that you're going to get to be able to make a better decision. As of now, I mean, I'm guessing he will still go, and if he goes, I'm going to put him in my lineup, but this is definitely a situation to watch.
It's such a shame because if he is fully healthy, which obviously right now he's not, he's dealing with an ankle issue, this was such a good matchup. I think that the offensive line for the Lions is going to be really, really good this year, and we didn't get to see it, even though he looked great in week one.
Oh, he looked great.
The Eagles' D-line is that's its own situation to deal with, so I was looking forward to him smashing this week, and this makes Jamal Williams a better play.
All right, I'm gonna throw this out here. The Tampa Bay wide receiver room is a hurt. Russell Gage with a hamstring, didn't practice. Julio Jones with a knee, didn't practice. Chris Godwin with the hamstring, didn't practice. Mike Evans with a calf injury, didn't practice. Leonard Fournette, a pass catcher, one of the primary ones that is available for Tom Brady. Limited with a hamstring. He is practicing today. But now do we have practice reports for today then as well, and Julio is not out there.
Yeah, Evans and Julio are not out there.
I mean, this is problematic for the Tom Brady start this week, is it not?
Yeah, it is. Tom Brady, obviously the Tampa Bay Buccaneers have not fared the best against the Saints.
He's
the
never beat him
interior,
as a Tampa Bay Buccaneer.
Yeah, the interior.
Whoa,
of the
really?
All in four.
Hot stat.
You have a real strength with the Saints defensive line and a real weakness with the middle of the Buccaneers offensive line. If he does not have targets healthy to throw the ball to, it's going to be a bad outing for Mr. Brady. I'm looking to pivot if I can. I mean, I'm not benching him for Jared Goff,
Stafford?
Or Marcus Mariota. But yeah, a Stafford,
like
a
Stafford
Derek Carr, those type of players. I will.
Winston in the same game?
Oh, man.
Who we may or may not be talking about later?
Well, then we'll talk about him later.
There you go. Think about it. George Kittle didn't practice.
Yarr. Mid groin.
Oh, that had so much more built into it. That was not a traditional groin injury. That's a long-term groin injury.
That's a sad, sad man.
Najee Harris limited, says he'll play in week two. I might believe Najee on this one.
Yeah.
Alan Lazard returned to practice on Wednesday. Mike, are you excited to see him on the field?
Yeah, much more than him being, on the side for week one.
T. Higgins, limited concussion. Made it through some of the protocol, not all of it.
That's
hopeful.
Really, really good, though. What you look for a player getting over the concussion protocol is just progression through the week. His timeline says, we don't know. It's unique to every person. But the timeline would indicate that he's on track to start.
Cardinals wide receiver Rondale Moore remains sidelined. Zach Ertz, he didn't practice, is expected to practice in full today, according to Cliff Kingsbury. And it's worth noting, he was on a snap count in week one for the Cardinals, managed to sneak into the end zone for some garbage time. But they expect him to play a much larger role and have a much larger allotment of snaps this upcoming week. And it's just worth noting in the matchup against the Raiders, because when Greg Dortch gets, 9 targets?
I believe so.
There's opportunity, let me just say that, for Zach Ertz and Hollywood Brown to have bigger weeks.
I think that makes it difficult, though, of like, can you start Zach Ertz? Or where Greg Dortch felt like a pretty decent flyer with that target share that he got last week, and they're going to have to score a bunch against the Raiders. Can you play either of those guys with any confidence now?
Not Dortch.
I don't play either one with confidence. Kyler came out this week and talked about not getting the ball enough to Hollywood Brown. He said that the best receivers in the league get 10-plus targets every single week, and that's what we need to do with Hollywood. So I expect him to force the ball to Marquise Brown a little bit more this week than he did last week.
I expect that as well. Mac Jones returned to practice. Looked pretty healthy.
Yep.
TJ Watt for the defense, the Steelers, he's been placed on the injured reserve list. He's out at least 4 games. Michael Gallup, unlikely to play in week 2, but did some team drills, working his way back. They need him, but I don't think you're going to start him until Dak is the quarterback.
Oh, I think he'll get back before Dak.
I think he'll get back before Dak, but I said I don't think you're going to start him as a fantasy player.
I got you.
Is the quarterback.
I thought you meant the Cowboys aren't going to start him
is
back. No,
they'll give it their all.
That makes a lot more sense.
All right, that was today's news and notes presented by USAA Insurance. Learn more at usaa.com/insurance.
Fantasy Forecast.
The New York Jets at 0-1 take on the 1-0 Cleveland Browns. The DraftKings Sportsbook line, Cleveland -6.5 at home. The over-under is 39.5 points.
Juicy.
What? I mean, this is the matchup we wanted when we said, hey, NFL, let's get this season going. Give me some Flacco versus Brissett. Let me just let the fireworks erupt over the field. That's one dud. That's someone shoots the firework up. Nothing explodes and everyone goes home.
This is like 1952 football.
It's not going to be good. I mean, Brissett is awful. I'm just going to say it.
Yeah.
He may be a good leader in the locker room, but his skills have declined over the years, every year. He's got a 6.4 yards per attempt. It's gross. If you are chasing the Donovan Peoples-Jones 11 targets, you have things to worry about. I'm not saying you can't give him a shot because somebody's going to catch some passes, but 39.5 point over under. Nick Chubb looked outstanding. Kareem Hunt looked outstanding. And the Browns can win this game on the ground. I mean, they can absolutely send Myles Garrett at Joe Flacco with great success and then win the game on the ground. I don't expect – like, I wouldn't start Cooper and Donovan Peoples-Jones with any sort of enthusiasm.
No, I wouldn't either. In fact, any pass catcher, David Njoku, I would rather. There's other options that I think I would rather start. Maybe continue to stash him. Not Cooper, not Donovan Peoples-Jones. Really, there's three assets you could play from the Cleveland Browns. It's Nick Chubb, Kareem Hunt, which are both good plays, and their defense.
On the other side of the ball, there are some questions, particularly in the running back room for the Jets, as well as the wide receivers. Let's start with the running backs. Michael Carter, I mentioned it, 10 for 60 last week on the ground, 9 targets, was on the field a ton. Breece Hall did get 10 targets, and I think that will go up. I think both rookies, Breece Hall and Garrett Wilson for the Jets, their coach came out and said basically, look, these guys got to grow up quick. We need them. And I agree. I mean, these are explosive players that you have to get the ball in their hands, but I'm not sure this is you flip the switch on Breece Hall this week.
No, it's not the time, because last week all those targets, they were a great indication of future success, but that doesn't necessarily mean it's this week. Last week, that was a faster pace of play from the Baltimore Ravens, who in neutral game script were throwing the ball a ton, and this is going to be a very slow-paced Browns team running the ball, draining the clock. I don't expect that if Flacco comes out and throws it a ton, that he could even get close to his 59 attempts in this game. He's going to be inefficient with a lot of attempts. He's going to be inefficient with a few attempts. So there's not really anyone I love here. I still, if I've got to pick someone to play, it would be Elijah Moore.
Yes. Of the Jets wide receivers, it's Elijah Moore, who last week it was, 7 targets, but he ran 55 routes compared to the other guys who are Elijah Moore is the main guy for the New York Jets as of now.
I do think I am playing Garrett Wilson. I am really backed up against it.
Oh, yes.
I have a league where it's MVS or Garrett Wilson. I'm going to go with the young rookie who, it was impressive to me. I mean, 8 targets, 4 for 52, has some juice. I think a big play is very possible there. I don't blame anybody for shooting the shot on MBS, I think, is very close. Yep. Would you guys both go MBS over Garrett Wilson because of the matchup?
I would, yes.
Maybe I'll change. I don't know.
Looking into the matchups more this week, I would flip to MBS.
Maybe I will. Maybe I will, guys, by the end
of
this show.
Maybe I won't.
The Washington Commanders, 1-0.
Manders.
Taking on the Detroit Lions. Lions. At 0-1. The DraftKings Sportsbook line. Detroit minus 1.5 at home. The over-under is 48.5. So Guns Mahoney gave it his all, still 0-1. This is the first time that the Lions have been favorites in a game since November 2020 against the Panthers.
Good work, Lions.
They weren't a favorite at home at all last year.
They were bad.
Did you watch
the Lions? Yeah. So Riverboat Ron, Guns Mahoney facing off. What's interesting about this game is it's got a high over-under, 48.5 points. You have two offenses that, look, Jared Goff can throw the football, and they could certainly be down. It should be a competitive game. Carson Wentz looked great in week one. Detroit allowed 455 total yards, third most in the league. So are there opportunities here for fantasy goodness?
There are a ton of opportunities here. This is a game that I think I would, if I had to bet over or under, I would go over on this game, because the Lions offense looked pretty darn good week one against the Philadelphia Eagles. The Manders got it together as the game went on last week as well. So neither defense scares me, and I think both offenses have enough pieces and some exciting young, fresh pieces, some athletes like DeAndre Swift and Jahan Dotson that can break a big play and then just have scoring go back and forth. So in this game, I love Antonio Gibson. Obviously, you're starting DeAndre Swift. But the ancillary pieces, Jamal Williams, I think you can play, especially with the ankle injury to DeAndre Swift. And we've had a lot of debate and discussion. I think a lot of it was on the party room yesterday. I don't remember how much was on the main show about Curtis Samuel, who I think is a fine start this week.
I'm very excited to see what the Manders wide receiver core does this week. Of I mean, all three of them came through. It was kind of a Terry McLaurin bomb touchdown that saved his day. Well, the rookie Dotson had the multi touchdowns, but Curtis Samuel, when it comes to at least just opportunities, Curtis Samuel was the one who got far more than the other players. 11 targets, 4 carries, and you like it's hard to remember, but back in 2020, back when Curtis Samuel was on the Panthers, like after week 6, he was really, really solid for fantasy purposes, finishing as a top 24 options in the vast majority of those games, was brought in with the big contract. So I'm excited to see, does that carry over? Like, you can't say for sure after week 1 that Curtis Samuel will be the guy. You can't say that Terry McLaurin will be the guy with just what's happening for that wide receiver core. So very excited to see how it shakes out. When it comes to my own lineup, though, I would be willing to play all three of these wide receivers as a flex type.
Amon-Ra, we're going to talk about him later. Oh, he's a great start. DJ Chark was 4 for 52 and a touchdown last week.
8 targets, like one of the league leaders in air yards this past week. DJ Chark is going to be, I think, underrated, undervalued the entirety of the year, and then just end up finishing in the top 36.
I don't think the entirety of the year, because I think Jameson Williams will get back and muddy the water for him.
Perhaps.
I think maybe until then.
Okay, well, but that's a while. I mean, Jameson Williams, I think they said they're hoping for November.
Okay.
So that's forever from now. I don't care about November right now.
Yeah, he's technically on the 4-game IR, right?
Yeah.
Correct.
What, he's on the IR, which you can come back after 4 weeks, but you can stay there forever.
Let's, Jason, putting your, yeah, do you have the courage to start Wentz or Goff over Brady?
Oh, baby.
I don't have the courage to start Wentz or Goff over Brady. I do think that they are streaming options for someone that lost Dak, but I would still go Brady over, you know, unless Julio is gone and Russell Gage is gone and Mike Evans is gone. Then sure.
What about TJ Hockenson? Last question on this matchup. 91% of snaps, kind of just TJ Hockenson.
Yeah, I mean, if you've got him, you're going to start him, and you're just hoping you get a touchdown.
All right.
And you won't.
And you won't. Quick break here, and then we're back with another matchup. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers at 1-0 taking on the 1-0 New Orleans Saints. This game has a 44-point over-under, and the DraftKings Sportsbook line is Tampa Bay on the road, -2.5. I could see that line moving around quite a bit depending on availability of the wide receivers and Leonard Fournette. Like I said, since becoming a Buck, Brady, 0-4 against the Saints. He went 375-4 last year, still lost the game, but the Saints have actually won 7 straight regular season matchups against Tampa Bay, and I think it continues. This is one where, look, I'm not going to say almost upset because the line's too close, but the Saints are winning this ballgame.
Wow.
Book it.
Okay. Yeah, I picked them to win as well. I think that they match up well here and that the Tampa Bay Buccaneers offensive line struggles are going to be an issue when they don't have a good, healthy wide receiver core. Now, the running game, Leonard Fournette, assuming he's healthy, and he's back at practice, so I you know, we didn't mention it, but he kind of limped, or maybe I did
we
in
did.
The waiver
we
show,
did.
How he limped off the field, didn't come back. Rashad White feels like a must-stash guy. But Fournette will play, it seems, and if that's the case, he should be awesome with dump-offs. I mean, you're talking about a guy who at the end of the year, I feel like he's going to be an 80 reception plus player.
Okay. So Fournette, we expect to be back out on the field. Do you take the approach with the wide receivers in Tampa of active equals start? Evans.
Yeah.
Jones.
Yep. Sorry, I'm distracted by greatness.
What?
The dump truck.
I wasn't sure.
Oh, it's great.
I shared a little message in the company Slack because as Jason was saying how he's going to be great with dump offs, I was like, Leonard Fournette, the dump truck.
Oh, and he's got the,
because,
he's
mean,
got
like,
the junk in the trunk,
just,
too.
He's got the big muscular.
Hold
booty.
On. I've got a thought on this.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
Oh,
okay.
Yeah.
I mean, like,
the dump truck?
Like, we.
Yes.
Deucers, are we approving this?
Deucer approved.
Official, my goodness. Nickname.
It's like we didn't. No one wanted him.
Oh, who wants a dump truck?
Yeah, you know, like you feel like, ah, it's just garbage, but it's delicious garbage.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, I mean that's perfect. How it feels like this.
I couldn't figure out what you were laughing about.
Came up a long time ago.
I wasn't sure. If you go back, you could check the tape.
Of course, the deucers like the dump truck.
Of course, right. But you can see the smile go across my face because it tickled me.
You know, sometimes it just happens, Mike.
All right.
Well done.
Dumps like a truck.
I think well done.
Thighs like what? Deucers? Goodness gracious.
All righty. Well, on the other side of the dump truck, we have Alvin Kamara. Super Kamario.
I need him to get that star power back.
Are you worried?
I am not personally worried. I know he didn't hit that carry threshold, but we've looked back and seen that the elite players are the ones that don't really qualify for that threshold. We've seen Alvin Kamara be great, and I was a smidge worried when they signed Latavius Murray. But it looks like the Latavius Murray signing is actually more for Mark Ingram, who was missing practice. So if anything, this means that more work should go Alvin Kamara's way. It's not a great matchup. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers have a very good run defense, but thankfully Alvin Kamara can be used in the passing game. You know, it is interesting. The one area of worry is just the question of how much will his passing work come down now that there's a good wide receiving core. Michael Thomas looked great. Chris Olave is great. And Jarvis Landry looked really good.
He did. And I'm trying to pull up the box score here to remember. So this past week we saw 4 targets from Alvin Kamara. There was a week where Alvin Kamara last year, week 4, he had 0 targets, and that corrected itself up to 8. So I think that the team will go back to him and realize that even with a much better wide receiver core, Alvin Kamara is still, I mean, you could, maybe Thomas is a better pass catcher than Kamara, but he's second best on this team at worst right now.
Okay, so Andy, I know you like Jameis Winston.
Yes.
And this game, who would you start, Jameis Winston or Tom Brady?
If Brady has Evans and Julio and we're very confident, then I'm going to stick with Brady. I don't think it's time to pivot away in that situation yet. And, you know, I like Winston a lot this week. I think the weapons showed themselves and Kamara was banged up and you still saw a really nice second half from Winston. But let's not pretend that Tampa Bay's defense isn't very, very good. They were the only team to not give up a touchdown in week 1. So there are risks with Jameis, even if you like what's going on. I think a lot of people want to see what Julio can do. So I hope he's back out there.
Yes.
The opportunity's right in front of him. You're not going to have Chris Godwin for a while.
No, it's a great spot start for Julio if he plays. And then Michael Thomas would be the first man up. I tried to trade for Michael Thomas in 2 different leagues this week. I was unsuccessful, but I am believing more and more that Michael Thomas is just fully back.
It's time for Taysom talk.
Oh, no.
Welcome in, everybody.
No.
Taysom Hill, 4 routes run, 4 rush attempts, tight end.
Sweet.
Tight end for the 1-0 undefeated New Orleans Saints. Put the team on his back.
I loathe. I will never play Taysom Hill.
Taysom talk.
And this is where I have to. I will eat crow here. I thought it would be Adam Trautman as the pass catching tight end for this team. It was not. His blocking was too required for this team. And Juwan Johnson ran 32 routes. He was the pass catching tight end for this team.
Got a red zone target.
So if I'm playing a tight end for the Saints, it is Juwan Johnson. It will never be Taysom.
Oh, I would play Taysom Hill over Juwan Johnson.
Yeah, I will play
100 out of 100 times.
I will play the guy who is running 32 routes, not 4.
What about
routes?
The one that had the really good week for fantasy?
Often does. Who has paid a lot of money.
He does not often have a good fantasy
more
week.
More or less
than Juwan
than
Johnson.
Juwan Johnson.
More. Far more.
He was the number 3 tight end on the week this week.
I actually went and looked when we were putting together our DraftKings lineup for tomorrow's showdown.
Okay.
And I was sad to see that Taysom Hill is listed as a quarterback on DraftKings, so I could not throw him in as a tight end.
Taysom Hill last year, when he was not the quarterback, I guess these ranks might be his quarterback finish, but I'll give you his yardage. One, that's yards. One total yard.
You can't say yards if it's one.
Just please 16, 32, in which he scored in a couple games.
Yeah, that's the issue. The issue is not that I think he's going to be a volume-based play in the receiving game. That's irrelevant. It's just how many fantasy points does he score because he's used in the red zone as a weapon to score touchdowns.
His touchdown was not a red zone last.
You cannot really be starring Juwan Johnson over Taysom Hill.
Yes, I can. I would 100%
But that's because of
that.
Hatred and anger.
Yes. No. That's letting bias take over.
No, that is because of statistical probability. The person who is out there running 32 routes, I will take that player over the one that runs four.
So should we water?
Yeah, but how many
that on the board?
How many carries does Juwan Johnson receive? How can you not weigh that at all?
Because carries are just the him getting the huge play, I'm not going to bet on that.
Will you bet on the 13 lifetime receptions by Juwan Johnson?
It was a complete flip.
Sorry, it's 15 total.
Okay.
In his career. You guys are water betting Taysom Hill and Juwan Johnson?
Put that on the board.
Water bet.
I will stand up for math.
Yeah, but I mean, I think you should just stay out of the Saints tight end
room.
Yeah,
I mean,
stay out of the tight end room.
Oh, that's
in New
perfectly
Orleans.
Fine. I was trying to.
No, I mean you in particular. You specifically should get the heck out of the tight end room in New Orleans.
I was just trying to express that is the level of tight end I will play over Taysom Hill.
Okay, all right. We'll be back next week with Taysom talk. Carolina, 0-1, taking on the undefeated New York Giants. The over/under in this game is a 43.5. So the Ben McAdoo revenge game takes place here. DraftKings Sportsbook line, New York, -2. The Giants in home games have not hit the over in 12 consecutive games. And while I understand Saquon Barkley put the team on his back quite literally last week to win the ballgame, it wasn't a pretty sight on offense. It was Saquon with a huge play down the sideline and Sterling Shepard with a huge play from Daniel Jones. I know the numbers looked okay for Daniel Jones from a completion percentage standpoint, but there's so much more to the game than that. He took 5 sacks. Decision-making was Daniel Jones-esque. Am I wrong in the view of Daniel Jones? I don't want to be cruel to the Giants fans who have a glimmer of hope.
Yeah, I mean, you can have a glimmer of hope. You got a good win against a very well-coached, usually well-prepared team. And I think there are, you know, there's reason for hope in this matchup. I picked the Giants to win and beat the Panthers. That being said, I would also take the under on this game. This doesn't seem like the offense didn't show me that they were elite for the Giants. The Panthers showed me, you know, the Ben McAdoo. Yeah. And just foolhardiness.
McAdoo and Rule joining forces.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, this is like the two worst superheroes deciding to create a tandem.
Yeah, what could go wrong?
Who are the two worst? That's like, what, like Hawkeye's getting in there with?
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's like, okay, whatever.
Can't get it off the top of my head, but that's a good start.
Yeah. I don't know. Hawkeye may be too.
Hawkeye's really good. I mean, I feel like that was a super compliment to them.
You're starting Saquon and no one else on the entire Giants offense. Is that fair? I'm not touching Kadarius Toney. He'll hit every waiver wire if he stinks this week.
Just to reiterate, we talked about Toney. Do you drop him? I'm not dropping him. I'll go one more week. If he is still truly in the doghouse where he's just not even on the field,
Kadarius phony.
Then you can move on. It's like. Giving the statement of, you know, like the Giants didn't prove anything to you on offense, it's because they have their best player at the wide receiver core not playing. They're making great decisions on that front.
On the other side,
the game, and it's so frustrating.
On the other side, is it McCaffrey and no one else?
No.
So DJ Moore is the type of player that you need to just take your lumps, put him in your lineup. We've seen this for years.
Yeah.
He's going to have big games. you can't always predict. Sometimes the matchup looks great. He doesn't come through. Sometimes the matchup looks bad, and he dominates. You just need to start DJ Moore every week. I think the real question mark in this game is Robbie Anderson. It was one bomb touchdown that really made his fantasy finish really juicy, but he was on the field for 100% of snaps, full-time player.
Eight targets.
So there are, you can make an argument that Robbie Anderson is a good flex option. I'm not chasing it personally, but I'm watching. I will certainly be paying attention to the pecking order of targets in this game.
The only glimmer of hope with Robbie is a different quarterback. But
yes,
he's always flashed with big games. He was 85% snap player last year when he was a disaster.
Yeah, I let last year's disaster get too much in my way on, like, cuz my gut reaction to this was no. I'm throwing that away, you know, but there was eight targets, and it was 2020 when he was an 1,100-yard receiver. The change of quarterback and the change of tendencies, I think, could end up being a huge deal for Robbie Anderson. So I'm in agreement with Jason. I'm not playing him this week. I'm not chasing it, but I'm definitely watching it. If he ends this game with seven or more targets, then I think that you're back to what Robbie Anderson could be played as a wide receiver three-ish.
Christian McCaffrey had 14 opportunities. That's the fewest in a game he started since week 7 of 2018. Any worries?
Any worries with – Did you say Christian McCaffrey?
Yeah.
No.
I feel like
you acting.
I feel
not
like you need a timeout.
Are you worried about the opportunities he received? I think that's a fair question. I think there are people that drafted McCaffrey at number one.
Yes.
And are saying, oh no, 14 opportunities.
No, if you look at the behind the scenes numbers, routes run, snaps, he was an absolute. He basically was the best running back behind the scenes, not necessarily in specific opportunities of touches and targets, but he is full-time bell cow, major utilization. No worries for Christian McCaffrey at all.
We do have some breaking news.
Oh, yeah. Leonard Fournette.
So our production team just completely tuned out of the show.
One of them.
and they went all in. Are you joking?
I love it.
Oh, my God.
Leonard Fournette, everybody.
The dump truck.
New England.
Oh, my God.
At 0-1, taking on the Pittsburgh Steelers at 1-0. The DraftKings Sportsbook line, New England minus 2.
Over, all night long.
The over-under is 40. 40. Gross.
Yeah, this week of football.
Do you play Najee if he's active? Is it just kind of like,
yep,
you have to, right?
Yep, you sheer force of volume.
And, you know, Deontay Johnson, 12 targets, 7 for 55. 55! Deontay Johnson is always in your lineup.
Yep.
And in a week where they kind of, yes, they struggled on offense, they stole the game. I mean, they really did. They stole it from the Bengals. They had two chances to win. I guess the Bengals were trying to steal it back. So, whatever. It was a very close game. But Deontay's in your lineup.
Mm-hmm.
I think Pat Freiermuth, the Muth,
oh, for sure,
very Luth last,
yes,
week.
So Luth.
Highest target share of all tight ends, yep, in fantasy football, 27.6%.
Yeah, it was I did not project that Mitch Trubisky would allow him to get so Luth, but he's in, man. He's, mm-hmm, he's a top 10 play until we see otherwise.
I know. Heading into the season, I was really,
yeah,
warming on Pat Freiermuth.
You did.
Looking at those rookie numbers saying, who do I even trust in the, you know, you trust George Pickens? No. Claypool? Not really. Although he got six rushes last week, so that's interesting. But from a trust standpoint, is Deontay and the Muth.
Yeah, yeah, completely agree.
On the other side, Damian Harris, Ramondre Stevenson. I think they're both very interesting this week. I think they should both be in fantasy lineups.
Yeah, they're both flex options. You know, you could certainly play them in this matchup with the injury that happened.
T.J. Watt. Is that what you're talking about?
I wasn't.
Oh, you meant Ty Montgomery.
I was talking about Ty Montgomery, but both.
But yeah.
Why not both?
Sure. Any wide receivers you're touching on the New England side?
No.
Low over-under.
I mean, no. If you're in a full PPR and you're desperate, I guess Jacoby, but.
This used to be the Brady-Big Ben matchup.
Yep.
Now it's a 40-point over-under, and we're not that excited. So, and Najee is a little scary because he's coming back in 1 week. He didn't play another down in that game. He looked like he was in a ton of pain. I still think you have some element of re-injury risk. Now, you're probably, if he's starting, you got to play him.
That's the problem is.
But what if you have Jamal Williams and DeAndre Swift out this week? Are you just pivoting then?
Oh, if DeAndre Swift is out, then I could be talked into it. But if Swift is active and I fully expect that, then no. It's just when you have it's who can you actually start over? Maybe you grab.
Let me give you some names.
If you got Jeff Wilson off of the waiver wire, if you were the winner of the of that lottery, then I can be talked into.
I had a dream Jeff Wilson scored 40 something points.
Oh man.
Then it's going to happen.
Yeah.
That's all I've got to say.
Dreams come true on this show. You know, what if you – let me give you a couple names just to test the Najee Waters inefficient, bad matchup currently dealing with injury. Would you start A.J. Dillon over him?
Yep.
Oh,
I would.
Yeah.
What about Clyde Edwards-Helaire?
No.
You have to do that tonight.
Would you? Would you do that tonight?
I'm not that worried about Najee not playing, if that is the thing making the difference.
No, I'm saying just better fantasy output this week.
Oof, that's a really tough
call. And based on where you where these players went in drafts, it's realistic that you could have Antonio Gibson. I would start Gibson over Najee as well.
I would start Clyde over Najee.
Okay. Anything else from this matchup you guys want to talk about?
Please, no.
The Indianapolis Colts, who are 0-0-1, travel to Jacksonville to play the 0-1 Jaguars. The DraftKings Sportsbook line, Indianapolis -3.5. The over-under is 45.
Andy's almost upset of the week.
I know I've accomplished my goal. If I get a certain expression on Jason's face, I got a certain expression on Jason's face.
I was just...
I don't mind it.
No, I don't mind it either. I was just surprised. I haven't heard you... talk up the Jacksonville Jaguars. So what did you see that's making you feel like this matchup will be closer? Was it more anti-Colts or pro-Jags?
It's more disappointed in what I saw from the Colts offense. Frank Reich has never won a game in Jacksonville before. 0-4.
What?
And
man,
hot
stats getting me today.
Yeah.
I did not know.
Getting slammed by the hot stats. But this should be a more exciting game for fantasy purposes. The over-under is 45. I like what I saw from Kirk and James Robinson and Travis Etienne. And even the peripheral targets that move the football down the field to give Jacksonville a chance to score. Zay Jones, Evan Ingram, Marvin Jones. They have weapons. And Doug Peterson is at least some stability in what you're going to get on offense. So I think Jacksonville will keep up. Matt Ryan was not impressive to me. That doesn't mean you are sitting his main man. Michael Pittman's going to get, 10-plus targets every week all year long?
Hopefully.
So he went 9 for 121 in week one, the wide receiver 5 overall. But the problem for the Colts offense is beyond Taylor and Pittman, there doesn't seem to be, fluidity, continuity? I don't know the word for it.
I believe the word is talent.
Ah.
Well, and
it's a much shorter word, easier to say.
And Alec Pierce, their rookie wide receiver, second round pick for the Colts. He's officially in the concussion protocol, right?
Yes.
Because they said that he left the game and then started to experience the concussion like symptoms. So we don't know if he is going to play. As far as anyone you can trust, it comes down to Pittman and Taylor, and keep your eye on Kylan. Kylan Grayson ended up being the tight end who received the targets for this team.
Yeah, I'm not gonna.
Did I say his name wrong? Granson?
I thought it was Granson.
Yeah, it is Granson. Yes, okay. You are correct.
Yeah, I'm not digging that far into the dumpster.
I just 7 targets.
Sure, he's been on my dynasty roster for, the past year because of the eventual departure of Jack Doyle and just believing that Mo Alley is a cap.
And he's a second-year player to receive that many targets in the first week.
How many was it?
7.
Yeah.
You have to pay attention at least. Not starting him.
Sure.
But you got to keep an eye
on a team that doesn't have a number 2 target.
Yeah.
And Nyheim Hines is – he was pretty good last week, had enough targets. But this game, I mean, I know, Andy, you're projecting the almost upset, but last week they were down 20-3 and needed to pass the ball a lot more, and that's where Nyheim Hines came in to play. I don't think this one will go necessarily that way, route. That's not how I'm projecting it, so I would rather sit Nyheim Hines. It's really Pittman and Taylor.
Okay. All the rankings, the start-sit tool, all the articles for the week, thefantasyfootballers.com. Go check them out. If you need more answers, we'll be getting into the rest of the matchups on tomorrow's show. Time to move on to the starts.
Starts of the week.
Well, I'll kick it off because we talked about this game. I'm going out on a limb with a deeper quarterback here.
I like it.
I don't know if I've done it before with this quarterback, but Jameis Winston is going to be my start of the week against Tampa Bay. I just don't know if running the football is going to be the solution. We saw Dallas kind of abandon the run. That is something teams do often against Tampa Bay. They gave up 307 passing yards per game on the road last season, and Jameis was the number 7 quarterback in week 1. You have 3 legitimate weapons in Michael Thomas, Chris Olave, and Jarvis Landry, and a 4th out of the backfield in Alvin Kamara. I think it's going to be pretty good for Winston this week in a bounce-back game that the Saints end up winning.
Yeah, that makes sense. My start of the week is Derek Carr against Arizona. Andy, yesterday you...
Send in the car. Send in the car.
You coined Arizona's secondary as a tertiary, which is great because they are awful. They were destroyed in week 1 by Kansas City. The Raiders should be able to do the same. In week 1, Las Vegas ranked 3rd in neutral pass rate, 8 in pass rate over over expectation. And Derek Carr averaged 293 passing yards at home last year. Safe floor. He's got his new shiny weapon that nobody on the Cardinals can guard. And they have the Raiders have an implied team total of 28.5 points, tied for 2nd most this week. I think Derek Carr is he is one of those guys that
you'd go over Brady for
sure. Yeah, I would start over Brady.
Mike.
And I'm calling for a bounce-back week for Matthew Stafford. Gets to play.
Can't stop Allen Robinson.
He gets to play against the – I'm fine playing Robinson. He's playing the Atlanta Falcons, who are just torched by Jameis Winston. I know it was a second half, had to come back, but Jameis looked great. 29 implied points for the Los Angeles Rams. Meanwhile, the Falcons allowed 28 points per game on the road last year. And it's Sean McVay coming off of a loss. He is one of the coaches that really bounces back. He gets his team ready after a loss. So I think it would not be surprising to see a 3 passing touchdown game. And they 29 points. They still can't run. Darrell Henderson is the primary running back. They still can't run the ball very well.
I like how everybody wants to say that like it's going to be a struggle for the Rams because of the Atlanta DBs, as though Chris Olave and Mike Thomas Jarvis Landry didn't have any success last week. They have a good, cornerback room, but it doesn't mean that these guys can't find, Jair Alexander is very good.
Right.
It worked out for Justin Jefferson. So I'm with you on that. My running back started the week as a confidence play on a player that only had 8 opportunities or 8 touches. Aaron Jones against the Chicago Bears at home. LaFleur coming out and saying, look, anytime Aaron Jones comes out of the game with 8 touches, that's not good enough. He was electric. I think he was 9.8 a carry in this game. The transition on offense to a non-Devontae Adams offense is going to come through focusing on Aaron Jones and A.J. Dillon. So they're going to roll at home. 9.5-point home favorites. We haven't talked about that matchup yet, but he's averaged 88 total yards, 6 touchdowns in 4 games against Chicago in the last 2 years.
Yep. Running back, I'm going to stay with the hot hand. Antonio Gibson was awesome in week 1. He's going to Detroit in a dome. In week 1, Gibson was on 64% of snaps, and his utilization was absolutely elite.
And they used him correctly.
Yeah.
They were using him down the field as a pass catcher. Like, hey.
7 receptions.
Hey, this gigantic fast guy has good route running and tremendous hands. Maybe we should do something
about
it.
8 targets, 7 for 72 through the air. And last week, the Lions were gashed. 5.5 yards a carry, 4 rushing touchdowns by the Eagles. So Gibson is pretty much must start to me this week.
Am I a running back start? It is Jeff Wilson of the San Francisco 49ers. They are at home. They are nearly 10-point favorites against the Seattle Seahawks.
I heard he was going to score 40 fantasy points.
Yeah, we have the dreamer dreaming over here of the 40-point
I don't know how he does that at 2.7 a carry, but he does.
The Broncos last week just ran for 5.3 a carry. We're talking about Melvonte up there in Seattle. He was the one who handled all the running back duties once Elijah Mitchell left the game with the knee injury. And last year, the 49ers averaged over 130 rushing yards per game at home. It's how they want to play.
The wide receiver start of the week I'm going with has the potential to sneak into the top 5 on the week. Yes, I believe Amon-Ra St. Brown can do it.
Yeah.
Against Washington. Going back to 2021, Amon-Ra St. Brown, 8-plus catches, 10-plus targets in 7 consecutive games.
That's nonsense.
That stat, Mike, to hit you in the face with another one, that is the 5th player in NFL history to accomplish that.
Like I said, that's nonsense.
So he 32% target share. Washington got killed from the slot by Christian Kirk last week. It's going to be really good for Amon-Ra this week.
Yeah. In addition to all those great stats, he's really good.
Yeah.
Like, Amon-Ra is very good. At wide
the
receiver,
sun god.
You just brought up a guy who did great last week, Christian Kirk.
Yeah.
I'm taking him as my start of the week versus Indianapolis. At this point, we have to consider Christian Kirk a wide receiver too. He is being targeted like a top 12 wide receiver, 91% snaps, 25% target share. He was 6 for 117 last week on 12 targets. The Colts defense is notorious for taking away the big plays but giving it up underneath, and you just talked about Kirk led all NFL wide receivers with 10 slot targets last week. That's where he's going to thrive. I think he's just someone that if he's
you
on
hoped
your,
to see it and you did.
Yeah, mm-hmm. If he's on your bench, it's probably a mistake.
I got Gabe Davis as my wide receiver start of the week for the Buffalo Bills.
Every week forever.
A 49-point over-under last week, 4 for 88, and the score on 98% of the snaps and a team-high 33 routes run. Like, he was out there more than Stephon Diggs. 16.1 air yards per target. I mean, end zone targets galore for this guy. Like Jason said, Gabe Davis is in your lineup every single week, but even after the huge performance in week one, Twitter still seemed very split on whether or not this can be sustainable production, and I'm here to say that I believe it is.
Yeah, I haven't looked this up because this would be ridiculous, but I just presume right now that a betting prop for him to score a touchdown is probably negative odds. Like, at this point, you're not even, it's just assumed he gets a touchdown. It's unbelievable.
My tight end start of the week on the island game here, Gerald Everett against Kansas City. The opportunity is going to be there tonight. So excited. What is 54.5 over under? Mm-hmm. Is it still
it
there?
Was.
Yeah, Gerald Everett with no Keenan Allen, 75% of snaps, scored last week, and it's, you know, tight ends with 20-plus routes run, over 2 yards per route, Kelsey, the Muth, Waller, and Everett last week. So this is a situation where at tight end, when I'm looking beyond the big names, I want a big game as a possible outcome, and Everett fits that mold for this week.
I absolutely love Everett. I would start him over my start of the week here at tight end, but
who this, I also love.
Yeah, I'm going with Robert Tonyan against Chicago. This is the home opener for the 9.5-point home favorite Green Bay Packers. The Packers wide receiver core is in shambles. I think they're going to get Lazard back. We hope.
It sounds like
come
it.
On. But he just couldn't connect with any of the other vets. Sammy Watkins looked awful. The rookies are still rookies, and there's been talk about the connection between Tonyan and Rodgers. When they get around the end zone, I think you're taking a shot off the waivers at a guy who could score a touchdown, and that is going to be how Tonyan gets his fantasy points, touchdowns from Aaron Rodgers in games where they score a lot. So you could do worse at tight end off the waivers.
And I'm giving a shout out to Tyler Higbee, which I get it. It's gross. It for how little of the production he had last week, he still had 27% of the targets. It was just a really rough game overall for all Rams, not named Cooper Kupp. Again, the implied team points of 29. And, the stat that the Taysom Hill people will love, Atlanta allowed over 20 points to the tight end position last week because Taysom Hill had his big fluky run. But I'll take Tyler Higbee out there running a bunch of routes. And when you don't have one of the big guys, you're just trying to find some volume. And if we get an 18% target share, which is a massive dip for a tight end, that'd be glorious.
I think Higbee's got to score against Atlanta. He's the parachute tight end to me. When they can't do anything on offense, they then turn to Higbee in the pretend running game. But I think he can score against Atlanta. There's going to be the opportunity there beyond Cooper Kupp. Like I said, the rankings in the start sit tool, thefantasyfootballers.com. We do have, of course, one more segment.
Jason Moore's ironclad, locked and loaded, 100% guaranteed boom, boom kicker of the week.
I'm on a journey, putting fools on a gurney, looking for a boom, boom best bay. Better not be frontin', lest you be stuntin'. Go with the Rams, Matt Gay.
I caught a bay in there.
Yeah,
he's got the cap B-A-E. On backwards.
He's my best bay. I'm on a journey to find a new best bay. Boom, boom.
You're a
Greg Joseph was all right last week, wasn't he?
He was great. He was the
who cares?
Kicker four.
Oh yeah.
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 I care about my kickers when I'm looking for an over on 1.5. It's all I care about. No one's even talking about him.
Yeah, but did you hear this?
Yeah, I heard it.
Makes me like Leonard Fournette a little bit more.
The dump truck?
Yeah, that's right. All right, that is going to do it for today's episode of the show. But don't worry. There's another podcast tomorrow. Check out the community at jointhefoot.com, and we will be back with you then.
Stay safe, everybody. Goodbye.
Thank you for listening to another episode of the Fantasy Footballers Podcast. Join our fantasy football community on jointhefoot.com and follow us on Twitter @TheFFBallers.